It is my pleasure to welcome and to present to you Sister Sheila Kinsey, a member of the Franciscan Sisters, Daughters of the Sacred Heart of Jesus and Mary. She is the Executive Co-Secretary for the Justice, Peace, and Integrity of Creation Commission of the Union of USG and UISG. She was appointed to the position in 2015 upon completion of her term as General Counsel for her congregation in Rome. She's actively involved in issues related to poverty, human rights, refugees and migrants, anti-trafficking, peace building, environment, sexual abuse and collaboration. And currently, she serves as the coordinator of the UISG campaign, Sowing Hope for the Planet. Sister Sheila, please.
Let's see where we are. Thank you for that introduction. It is a pleasure for me to be here with you and to share what's been happening with this campaign, Sowing Hope for the Planet. And I'm hoping that you can see this PowerPoint presentation. Please look at the screens for the PowerPoint. The words that are on the screen, don't pay attention to them necessarily. Only the words that are important will be the words that I will say. So this is a way of engaging you into this whole campaign and encouraging you to help us move it forward. So it's wonderful for me to be after looking at a new hopeful vision for religious life and talking about responsibility as hope for religious life, to continue then and looking at a commitment on the environment. When we speak of the environment, what we really mean is a relationship existing between nature and the society which lives in it. So, on June 18th, 2018, the UISG board launched the campaign, Sowing Hope for the Planet, to share efforts of women religious in putting together Laudato Si. Already, many religious communities have been engaged in deeply meaningful connections with Laudato Si, with the people and the earth, through the faith and words of Pope Francis. This realization led then to the awareness of this phenomenon deepening into a deeper interconnection, carrying then the message to a global network of religious working together to hear the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. This collective listening creates a collective voice, a collective power for making a message a reality. Not acting as individuals, but as a religious community, emphasizing the fundamental connection that exists between the environmental crisis and the social crisis that we are currently experiencing. And Pope Francis asks us for a personal and a communal ecological conversion, often reminding us that everything is interconnected. So the timing of this campaign comes with the growing awareness and urgency of climate change and the need to address its impact on the environment and society. But Laudato Si offers a spiritual relationship and solutions to a seriously critical situation that we are desperately needing a response in our world of today. Laudato Si begins with awareness and unfolds with inspiration, giving our sisters a voice, the influential power to make a difference, coordinating experiences that provide them and their connections the opportunity to become fully sensitive to the situations that are happening in our common home, so that we can dare to turn what is happening in the world into our own personal suffering, and thus to discover what each one of us can do about it. So the campaign provided an opportunity to not only develop a network that could spread throughout the world, but what is being done, but also to highlight the work of the women religious. For a long time, many have been actively working to stop the Earth's devastation and this devastation of its people. And this gathering highlights their actions and commitments. So a concept note was developed through the collaborative efforts of the Justice, Peace, and Integrity of Creation Secretariat and the Global Catholic Climate Movement through the initiative of UISG to bring together the richness and the connections of its members, member congregations, so that the interdependence obliges us to think of one world and a common plan. So we have pictured here Father Felix Mushibusi, who is co-executive secretary in the office with myself, and also Thomas Insura, who you'll see a little later in a video. So having a carefully developed plan has enabled us to fold into the framework new ways forward that would emerge from our experience with webinars and the knowledge of the evolving needs of care for creation. So our goal was to give every single sister whose superior is a member of UISG the opportunity to have a chance to make a difference in the care for the universe, and particularly for our common home. So the structure of the plan was to coordinate these efforts, to use the best means of communication, to evaluate how we are doing, to strengthen the coordination, to partner with organizations, and what we will be doing here today is develop a statement from this plenary to promote the position then of UISG. So then, to put some flesh and concrete action onto the plan, we then began to develop webinars, coordinated prayers in various translations, celebrating events that are happening, Season of Creation, World Water Day, Earth Day, and promoting activities that are ongoing with the global Catholic climate movement. So we developed a timeline for the 5 webinars to take place, kind of an organic development. They were not planned ahead of time, but rather they unfolded as we continued to listen to the voice of the sisters who are actively working on care for the environment or who had questions about how to do this better. So this transformation came following the natural passion and creativity of those involved. So thus, as Pope Francis states, change is impossible without motivation and a process of education. And he also says that prayer leads us forward in hope. So for each of the sessions, Father Felix would lead us in prayer. So we began to put this into reality. So the first webinar was then beginning to share with the participants on the webinar how we plan to go forward. So we were saying that everything is interconnected. We needed to look at what is happening to the environment and to what is happening in those who are poor, to begin to see in reality where we are with these situations and how can we work together. And the interconnection was not only with the reality of the world and the people that we are serving, but to see the universe as unfolding in the love of God, to gauge in that energy, in that contemplation, that beauty, which speaks to us of God's love. And a plan, and I necessarily have to go through that, but we answered a call to our own personal conversion. We looked at the objectives of the session, where we wanted to go with the campaign, particular actions that we were expecting of those who participated in the webinars, always unfolding in prayer and discernment to carry us forward, to celebrate the work that sisters have been doing, and to look at how we are affecting the reality, our ministries, our local communities, our congregational outreach to the world. The second webinar shows our collaboration with the DiCastri promoting integral human development, and many of our people were invited to the third anniversary celebration of Laudato Si. And in that session, very clearly, there was an emphasis with Pope Francis, what kind of world do we want to lead to those who come after us, to the children who are growing up, so that we can turn what is happening in the world into our own personal suffering, and then to discover what each of us can do about it. So in order to create this massive movement of all of us working together, we needed to be looking at kind of a way to organize our thinking. And this is certainly a process you see used in many of the encyclicals, like Laudato Si, certainly. Looking at what is happening in the world, judging with the critical hope, the reality, and then our own charisms from our congregation and our spiritual heritage of the church, and then acting together to make a difference. And as we thought about that, we wanted to include then what was happening in the world. You know, what's happening with the season of creation, to hear a little more about, the Synod on Youth, and COP24. So we began to look at some events that were happening in the world and trying to discover how can these be connected to us and the work that we're doing and also into our prayer life. So then we began to involve persons who are working in areas related to the environment. So the presence of strategic plans, where were these happening and how could these people who are doing these share with us? So we had a focus on what was happening with religious around the globe, and we chose Sister Margaret Gonzalez from India, who was working with youth, and Sister Janet, who was working in the United States, dealing at that time with the opposition to a gas pipeline that was coming through their territory. We engaged in an advocacy for them to see if that appeal would happen before the Supreme Court, but they denied the reception of that case. So again, a global connection. And then always we would hear from the global Catholic climate about the work they were doing. Season of Creation was a focus at that time. The fourth webinar dealt with the solidarity and interconnecting global and local concerns So we looked at how we are related one another, attending specifically to how those relationships are taking place. And with that experience, we went to Brazil and we got some input in terms of what was going on in preparation of the Synod. The experience of COP24, which was in Poland, the Global Catholic Climate was very involved, as was the Dicastery, as was our secretariat, seeing what we could do to promote issues related to climate change that needed to be addressed. We had Sister Anne Curry talk about the work with, as the coordinator of Justice and Peace. She's a religious of the Sacred Heart, how their community is organizing their efforts to promote issues related to the environment and what they can do about it. And Global Catholic Climate Movement talked about the divestment of fossil fuels and how to work in alternative energy divestments. And a season of Lent, at this time they were promoting to, for us to pull back on the use of meat because that often is related to climate change in terms of the use of the land. Oops. Well, I think, okay. And the fifth one of the webinars focused then on the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor, and deliberately dealt with the interconnection of the resources, highlighting avenues in Laudato Si, and again, deepening that interconnectedness. And from that experience, we heard from Australia and the Mercy Sisters and the program that they have carrying forward throughout their whole congregation and their institutions, raising up Laudato Si as a force of inspiration and action within their congregation. And then we also heard from two sisters, the daughters, Mary Help of Christians, dealing with work in India, in the United States, and also in Ireland, and you can see them a little bit later. And finally, the Catholic Global Climate Movement talked about their Earth Day coming up and their advocacy efforts for the 1.5 degrees Celsius that we do not want to exceed. We have about 10 years to look at that. So that's a very strong advocacy effort there. So the timing of this campaign and also dealing with the flexible framework for the campaign, we became more aware of the situations that the sisters were experiencing and how they richly shared what was happening. And so this became clearer that we needed to be able to balance the sharing of the work done in various countries, the diverse ministries, different stages of development, including what's happening around the world, and highlight this in terms of Laudato Si. And we needed to see and to emphasize that we grow in solidarity, responsibility, and compassionate care as a group of religious sisters. So with that in mind, we began to develop a website, which is in 6 different languages, so that we can put information for us to be able to communicate what we're doing and how we can share what is happening to fulfill the needs of each other in a way that we can work together. And it highlights the news here on the homepage, updates information. It has a map also showing where some of the where the resources can be located and the congregations that are connected to them. It has the goal page talking about our strategic plan, which I just mentioned. It has an events page, which is updated with both upcoming and past opportunities. So all the webinars that I mentioned are available there. They talk about the international days that we mentioned. So it's a way of keeping it current and making it available for our sisters just around the world. And the resource page is kind of the heart of the website. And it's a joint effort for sisters in their willingness and generosity to share their materials with one another. They're available for your use in any way that you would care to do so. And the contact page is for you to sign up and looking for a special place for the coordinators, particularly the contact person from each congregation. And you can see by this newsletter, we have issued two of them. It's once a month, so you're not overloaded with information. And this is in five languages. So that is pertinent for each of the congregations at this point, the five languages, and then German, of course, will follow because that's a recent development. So moving to the heart of the campaign, with the sisters listening to the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor and what they have been doing, we prepared a video demonstrating some of the situations which are both cries of the earth and of the poor. And then the second part shows the various works that sisters have shared with us from their engagement in their congregations around their actions and their mission.
Our goal is not to amass information or to satisfy curiosity, but rather to become painfully aware, to dare to turn what is happening to the world into our own personal suffering, and thus to discover what each of us can do about it. What kind of world do we want to leave to those who come after us? To children who are now growing up? The earth herself, burdened and laid waste, is among the most abandoned and maltreated of our poor. The great need for a sense of social responsibility on the part of consumers. We cannot allow our seas and oceans to be littered by endless fields of floating plastic. We need to pray as if everything depended on God's providence and work as if everything depended on us. There has been a tragic rise in the number of migrants seeking to flee from the growing poverty caused by environmental degradation. We must not allow the Mediterranean to become a vast cemetery. Us recognize that there is always a way out. The principle of the common good immediately becomes a summons to solidarity and a preferential option for the poorest of our brothers and sisters. Our world has a grave social debt towards the poor who lack access to drinking water because they are denied the right to a life consistent with their inalienable dignity. Cultivate a shared identity with a story which can be remembered and handed on. These community actions, when they express self-giving love, can also become intense spiritual experiences. Universe unfolds in God, who fills it completely. Hence, there is a mystical meaning to be found in a leaf, in a mountain trail, in a dewdrop, in a poor person's face. Thank you. creation is the order of love. God's love is the fundamental moving force in all created things. Everything is connected. Concern for the environment thus needs to be joined to a sincere love for our fellow human beings and an unwavering commitment to resolving the problems of society.
Okay. That really wasn't the end of it, but thank you for that. Okay, you can see the tremendous work, and it gives you a sense of the international feel for the congregations around the world. And I really want to thank all of those who contributed to this in any way. You know, much gratitude for the work that has happened. So as a unifying, you know, where are we at this point? You can find many of this information then on the website. Different categories that have developed as a result of input from the sisters, local and global communities, advocacy, parish work, congregational work, as well as looking at some statistical information that we have found and use of our resources that the document that we paired on the season of creation, we had over 2,500 views, and then World Water Day over 14,000. So we know that our resources are being used and that sisters are connecting then to the websites through the webinars, 600 sisters at this point, 370 communities. So that's very, very important for us to know where we are going forward with this. Three areas that we will be addressing this year too is dealing with the Synod on the Amazon, and also the work continuing with the Global Catholic Climate Movement, as well as the work with the Dicastery with events coming up that are in celebration of Earth Day and of the Laudato Si. So just to give you a flavor then of the sister here has prepared information related to the Synod that will allow us to get a sense of what that is and how important that is for us. This sister, Adelaia, she's a daughter of Mary, Help of Christians.
De una variedad infinita y de una enorme riqueza biológica, cultural y espiritual. Quienes no habitamos estas tierras, necesitamos de vuestra sabiduría y conocimiento para poder adentrarnos sin destruir el tesoro que encierra esta región. Y se hacen eco las palabras del Señor a Moisés: quítate las andanias, porque el suelo que estás pisando es una tierra santa.
Amazoniana, nueve nunca Samuel Bobanú Najal, Brasil, Bolivia, Colombia, Ecuador, Guyana, Perú, Surinam, Venezuela, Enclave, Guyana Francesa, algo 7,5 millones de kilómetros cuadrados, nunca Samuel Bobanuna, Achiawe, Amazonas.
Namak Amazonas Agnure, así nunca, y Nadukubilla, Luna Sumachi.
Hemos tenido una reunión donde han venido personas de diferentes regiones, de la sierra, de la selva y de la costa del Perú, para reflexionar sobre el sino panamazónico. Básicamente, la palabra sino significa caminar. Entonces, es una convocatoria para caminar con quién, con los hermanos de la Amazonía, que están enfrentando muchos problemas y que son ignorados, no solamente por el gobierno, sino también por la sociedad, por nosotros mismos.
Sínodo sigue siendo un término complicado para la mayoría de la gente. Se asocia mucho con esa cultura de obispo y de alto vuelo en la iglesia. Pero quiere decir en la práctica, iglesia caminando juntos.
Tuvimos un compartir muy bonito. Estos pueblos originarios expresaron sus preocupaciones y alegría donde viven ellos. Dicen que una de las preocupaciones que tienen ellos es el cambio climático. Hay mucha sequía, lluvia, disminución del agua de las quebradas, también de los ríos, por este cambio. Otros compartieron que hay mucha contaminación del medio ambiente y esa contaminación son de las empresas que están trabajando, del gas de camisea y de la extracción de petróleo.
Gracias al Instituto Bartolomé de las Casas, gracias a REPAM, por apoyo de ustedes, sentimos respaldados como indígenas, que somos Aguajuni Huaquís. Vengo de la provincia de Condorcanqui, Amazonas. Soy Aguajun, hablo Huaquís. Y también tuve oportunidad de aprender a hablar castellano. Y justamente en la segunda reunión territorial desarrollado en la ciudad de Yurimaguas, participamos diferentes organizaciones donde han mencionado que es CEPAO, Consejo Permanente del Pueblo Huajón. Antes era de los pueblos Huajón y Huampis, pero solamente somos Huajón porque Huampis ya se ha dado nación autónoma.
Bueno, yo pertenezco al pueblo Cucama, al milenario pueblo Cucama, pero quiero referirme a todos ustedes como... Así como yo me defino como indio Cucama, y este término indio para mí ya está desprovisto de todo sentido racista con que la sociedad dominante nos ha marcado. Liberado de esa carga racista, yo puedo asumirme como indígena, como originario, como persona.
So we'll be hearing more about the implications of that conference, that synod coming up in October, and the implications for us as religious, how we can work together, particularly with those of the indigenous population, as well as how that affects the environment with the Amazon area, so important to climate. The second video, the third video that I'd like to show is an interview with Thomas Insura, who is our partner with the Global, as the Executive Director of the Global Catholic Climate Movement, and he will share shortly some of the information that his organization does.
Warm greetings from the Global Catholic Climate Movement. My name is Tomás Insúa. I'm delighted to be sending a little message to the wonderful sisters of the UISG family. I was asked to share a little bit about the background of what GCCM is about and the work we do to support sisters and the wider church to live Laudato Si. So for an introduction, GCCM, we're a global network of about 900 Catholic organizations, all types of Catholic organizations, I would say majority of them religious orders. So we're delighted to count and have been working for the past 4 years already with a lot of religious orders, a lot of sisters that are very active with Laudato Si. Our main goal is to help the church live Laudato Si. We want this beautiful document of Pope Francis, Laudato Si, not to be to sit on a shelf, but rather to be a living document, a document that we turn into action. So And all of this work, we do it in close partnership with UISG, with especially Sister Sheila Kinsey, who sits in our steering committee. And we are, to give you a glimpse of the work we do, we see our work, I mean, living Laudato Si, happening in three dimensions. There are three areas of work in this challenge of putting Laudato Si into practice. First, it's all about the transformation of our hearts, ecological conversion that is needed. Second, it's about a transformation of our lifestyles, about the way we live, the impact, the environmental impact we have in the world, in creation. And third, it's about transforming the larger systems, the policies and structures that are destroying our common home, that are destroying creation. We need to raise our voice, calling for action from governments, from corporations. So a little glimpse about each of these three areas. In terms of the first one, we have a lot of eco-spirituality programming. One of the most important things, initiatives, is the Season of Creation, which happens every year in the month of September. It starts on September 1st, which is the World Day of Prayer for Creation, and it ends on October 4th, which is the Feast of St. Francis of Assisi. And this year, this is the special moment. It's an ecumenical initiative. It's this special moment in the year in which Christians care for creation. And the Season of Creation this year, given the theme of the Amazon, we have the Amazon Synod happening in October. This year, the Season of Creation will be all about preparing ourselves for this important synod of Pope Francis and the Universal Church about the Amazon and the issue of biodiversity, especially. And then we have other eco-spirituality initiatives, but that's probably the main one. The second area of work I mentioned is the transformation of our lifestyles, reducing our carbon footprint, our impact in the world. We have a new sustainability program that we're preparing. It's not formally launched, but if you're interested in it, here we have the challenge. We need to, all our convents and different facilities that sisters own, schools, universities, etc., all those buildings we have, they need to run on clean energy and renewable energy. We have a new program to help Catholic institutions do this work. So that's a new program. So that's also something you can find out more in our website. And third but not least, last but not least, it's our advocacy initiative. So here, for example, we have initiatives like the fossil fuel divestment campaign. Lots of religious orders have already divested from fossil fuels. That means not investing our financial resources of Catholic institutions into an industry that is destroying the planet, but rather be ethically consistent with our investments. That's an invitation we have for you. It's a very concrete way of raising our voice and making a statement. And also relatedly, another nice initiative are the climate strikes. You might have heard the youth climate movement, the students are mobilizing at a very big scale. There's this global climate strikes happening every 2 months. Millions are going out to the streets, millions of students. We're mobilizing the rest of the church to go and support the students and go out to the streets. We Catholics, the urgency is so great. We need to get out to the streets and raise our voice in support of their calls. And so in a nutshell, that's a very short summary of the work we do. We encourage you, the best way for you to continue learning about the work of GCCM is to join GCCM. As a member organization, your religious order can sign up as a member organization of GCCM. Now in the UISG plenary, we'll be collecting registrations to join GCCM, or you could do it online as well in our website. Visit our website, just Google Global Catholic Climate Movement. You'll find us easily. You can sign up. And second, also, if as an individual sisters can join as Laudato Si animators. It's a training, online trainings that we do, but also offline for those of you in Italy, in Assisi, we have a Laudato Si animators program that we do in person in Assisi. So please reach out to GCCM. We want to be in touch. Contact us. We would love to continue working together with sisters. You're leading the way. We need your leadership to continue inspiring the rest of the church. The urgency of the ecological crisis and climate change couldn't be greater. We need to work all together. Looking forward for more. God bless you all.
And then the third partner that we have is with Father Josh, who is at the Dicastery promoting integral human development. And we work with him on a number of areas related to the environment because that's his area of concentration. And moving forward then in the celebrations of the anniversary days of Earth Day and the fifth anniversary of Laudato Si, COP24. Well, now at COP25, all of those areas are important. So you can see as we move forward with the campaign, we're trying to engage many partners with us as we go forward. So then what are our next steps? We're looking at a unified voice, our collective strength, what's happening in the world, because we know that designated power structures usually are given the bigger voice. So we're trying to bring together our own loud voice to the table in many areas. And UISG is the unifying voice for the sisters around the world. And through this campaign, we have the opportunity to organize the voice of the sisters in the effort on many levels of structure in order to enhance and recognize our contribution to the care of our common home. And we will continue with the same format, organizing the webinars and continuing to receive feedback as we move forward to make sure that our participation together continues with the same momentum that we have already begun. So some of the input that we received as an evaluation of a survey is that we will need to put together some practical tools for those who are beginning to look at how can I engage my community in an effort to work with Laudato Si. Also, you heard from Thomas talking about the offerings that the Global Catholic Climate Movement have, and you can avail yourself going forward. There was a request to talk more about the divestment of fossil fuels and in alternative energies to consider sharing these ideas. They find the experience of the webinars and the resources really an important way of keeping us all together. So this interconnectedness in the different languages is a way that we continue to keep and increase the sisters' voice to what we are doing then with Laudato Si. With the webinars, even though we are at a global distance, we are continuing to find a way that we are experiencing growth together. And that as congregations in a spiritual context, we are following the gospel carefully through our actions, and we bring our celebrations and our joys, as long as the pain, to that table. So the campaign needs your support going forward to really thrive and to realize its potential. So if you haven't done already, we do need a contact person from every congregation. And I know that's the case because we have only 21 that are designated at this point. So your JPIC person or someone you would want to be designated, please have that person be a part. So when we talk about having this unified voice, in the previous session, you talked about the things that we wanted to do together. We have to engage in a structure that will allow us to do it. There needs to be a commitment there. Yes, we send out information to all 600 sisters that are already registered through webinars or their own initiative. But to really have an organized voice, we need to have someone responsible for seeing that that information is given out to all the sisters of their congregations. Because our goal is to have opportunities for every sister to be involved in whatever way is possible for them. So we get to the heart of this commitment for our common home, our environment. So we reflect on this past year, what we've been doing together, and taking seriously the call to take into our hearts the pain of the world, We accept the responsibility to determine what is ours to do. As international congregations, we need to look at the ways we have been guilty of the environment destruction and disregard for these consequences to one another and especially to the poor. Sisters are present in congregation in countries where the lifestyles negatively impacts the rise in temperature, affecting climate change, and where they are most affected by climate change. Our communities are both intimate with the cause and effect of climate change. And with our personal commitment to one another, really, there is no other organization that could do this than the sisters. We love one another in our families, of our communities. We know one another. We know the pain. We know what we're doing to cause problems. If any group could rise to this occasion, it would be the sisters. So when we look at this commitment, what is it that we are beginning to see as a community of sisters living the gospel in solidarity with one another, being interconnected, wishing to live this religious life as hope for the vision of a future, hope that contains responsibility, that we care for the common good of our environment and our common home. So in essence, may this be proposed to you as a pledge going forward. We commit ourselves to both personal and communal conversion, and we wish to move forward together in an orchestrated and coordinated response in listening to the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor as we go forth as instruments of prophetic hope in the heart of the world. As Pope Francis reminds us, all of us can cooperate as instruments of God for the care of creation, each according to his or her own culture, experience, involvements, and talents. So we're looking at a way can we be committed. I shared with you a structure that we have already put in place, an organic structure that we can begin to invite and involve everyone that would like to be a part of this. So please consider this request, this commitment of us going forward as sowers of hope for the planet. So at your tables, you have got some areas to consider. Please think about one that you could do for your congregation and how you can see yourself moving forward as members of UISG to make a significant difference to what is happening to our planet and in a way that we can be together, connected together, moving forward for the good of all creation. Thank you.
We just take a few moments of silence to process internally what we have just heard, especially the invitation of Sister for the commitment that we want to make.